I am so excited today. You know, a couple of weeks ago, I was on vacation. And when I came off vacation, I keep hearing this little buzzword going around the office called beautiful Grand Bahama, beautiful Grand Bahama. And I got an opportunity to go into a meeting with the minister. And she started to talk just a little bit, a small part about this idea, this program called beautiful Grand Bahama. And I think, like many other Grand Bahamians, you know, even as you drive around, the thought in my mind was, okay, this is just another cleanup program. Yeah. You know, some people cleaning up some stuff. And I sat next to her scribbling some things in my notepad. And I guess she might have seen what I was scribbling. And it didn't sit too well with her because I wasn't, don't tell her, I wasn't really paying that much attention, right? Y'all don't tell her. So when we walked out of the meeting, I'm heading to my office and she walks up and she points at me. She says, you, my office, now. Now, I've been married long enough to know, Brother Stanley, that when the boss lady do that kind of stuff, you're about to get one good little spanking. So I went in the office, you know, prepared now to get my little spanking. She said, sit down. She said, listen, you really don't understand what beautiful Grand Bahama is. And like many other Grand Bahamians, you got this concept in your mind for what you used to see in the past. And what you understand the other day, that all this is a cleanup program. She took about half hour and she started to outline to me what our vision was, what our plan was, what this, the holistic approach to this program. And I had to apologize because I had a small, narrow-minded view of what beautiful Grand Bahama really, really, really is. And I believe that unfortunately too many Grand Bahamians also have a narrow-minded view. But I sat in her office and I realized that this certainly is a new day. Because this little small lady, this lady who looked to be small in stature, she is a giant of a woman, because the amount of ideas she started to put out to me and the amount of things she started to talk through and talk about her heart for the people and talk about the rehabilitation and the revitalization of the Grand Bahama community, I said, Minister, whatever you're doing, I sign it up. Show me where to sign. I on board. I waken with this.
And I've been a part of the beautiful Grand Bahama clean up since the beginning.
This program actually gave me a sense of hope.
It's been tremendous impact in my life.
It's like a domino effect. We're not going to put everything out. We're going to shape it, then we're going to beautify it, and we're going to transform it.
Beautiful Grand Bahama Central has 194 people.
West End proper has a total of 35 workers into West End, and Eight Mile Rock has a total of 80 workers into Eight Mile Rock.
The program was only initially supposed to go from the missile base to McLeanstown, but we couldn't leave with Sweden's Key. So then we keep hiring a few more. So we started with 35 and we end up at 50.
So that's a lot of people that's employed.
I'm so proud of you.
This is your day, man.
You're doing an amazing job.
This is our story. The story of our resilience. The story of our hope. The story of our transformation. The story of beautiful Grand Bahama and what makes it more than just a cleanup. In September of 2019, Grand Bahama and Abaco were hit with one of the strongest hurricanes in the history of the Bahamas, Hurricane Dorian. The aftermath of this storm left our island in shambles. Compounded with the COVID-19 pandemic, it left our people out of homes, out of work, and out of hope. Naturally, this increased the crime rate, increased dependency on social services, and increased the desperation of persons to survive. But survival seemed just out of reach. Looking around our community was depressing. There was constant reminders of the devastation and loss. Many people left the island of Grand Bahama, and for those that remained, there was little hope in sight that Grand Bahama would feel like home again. And for about 2 years, it remained that way.
But after Hurricane Dorian, the state of Grand Bahama was really devastated. You know, plenty of homes was destroyed, and even top of the economy.
East Grand Bahama after Hurricane Dorian was in a terrible state.
Persons had lost hope. We didn't have any sense of security. Persons had no job. I think living in Amarok, the crime rate was at its peak.
I feel the state of Grand Bahama after Dorian is desperation.
Well, if everybody continued to work together and stop the crime and stop this and stop the next thing, things would be better. You understand?
Yeah.
Things will be better.
Everywhere you turn was garbage, debris, overgrown trees, vegetation, and it was a mess.
Many persons joined the unemployment line.
Well, it was in a state of despair.
The place was a mess. Everything, nothing was in order.
And the people, hearts were broken.
There are plenty of persons had like immigration status, persons who be in the school here and live here all their life, born here, but they didn't have the right papers. So they can't get a job, they can't travel, you know, make it difficult for them to get a passport.
Things seemed dismal for Grand Bahama, but there was a spark of hope. A new minister for Grand Bahama, and a new day beyond the horizon.
Well, living in the Barker Town community, we used to come in this area, trip circle, to play basketball on the court when the police used to live in these homes. And unfortunately, the homes was really run down, and trees, you couldn't even see the houses because they were covered with trees, how bad they was neglected. And I had the opportunity to bring the now Minister for Grand Bahama and MP for Pine Ridge through this area when she was just a candidate campaigning. We came through to meet a particular constituent. And when she saw the homes, she asked why they were in the state. And I informed her that they were owned by the government of the Bahamas and the police. And she was like in disbelief. She was like, wow, the government of the Bahamas, and they let this run down like this, knowing how many persons are homeless. And from right then, she mentioned a vision that we could turn all of this into halfway houses for battered females and for young men to give second chance programs. And you know, she just saw the vision from then. She had a vision for this area.
When we first got the call that we're going to start Beautiful Grand Bahama, and we had this first group of people, the energy was really good because a lot of people were looking for something to do. I guess a lot of people were, like I said, hopeless and didn't know where they're going to make the next dollar. So when it came along, had a lot of energetic people who just wanted to have something to do. So it was a good feeling to give people something to do, to put them to work.
Beautiful Grand Bahama has come in the right time for the island of Grand Bahama. It came in a time where I think a lot of those young men was trying to figure out what to do.
So it's a good thing. It makes me feel good. You know, I was in the process of looking for a job, and God answered my prayers.
I had a good experience today, and I just want to thank Moxey for giving us this opportunity.
It was a wonderful experience because I get to meet some new friends, new people along the way. It may take me from here, so I appreciate it. Thank you.
The government of the Bahamas had successfully implemented Beautiful Grand Bahama by first empowering the people in our very own communities, empowering them to do more, to achieve more, and to become more. But this journey had only begun.
And that's where Beautiful Grand Bahama came in. And when we start cleaning, and we start hiring people, and we start doing all these other works, I started to build the people morale.
The workers are now starting to see West Grand Bahama starting to shape up, and the work what they have been doing is starting to become beautified.
When we started introducing people into different areas of the Beautiful Grand Bahama, because we had like a landscaping crew, we had a cutting crew, we had a demolition crew, and then we had like skilled work. So we were mixing people up, and it was really exciting because putting people in different areas and they were learning stuff. And so the energy was really, really good. Like a lot of people learned a lot of stuff that they didn't know.
I think when the program first started, you know, when you hear Beautiful Grand Bahama, everyone look at it as most persons look at it as just a cleanup program. but this is not just a cleanup program. This is a holistic approach to transforming, you know, our communities. And
I am important.
I am God's person.
I am God's person.
I am love.
I am love.
I am perfect.
I am perfect.
And I am beautiful.
The bushes have to be beautified and maintained and well-kept, so this is where the chainsaw, the weed walker come into play. They would have learned the trade from the first phase that made them more comfortable into the second phase of beautifying this part of the program.
Well, I think the mentality of the person has really changed because now they have a sense of hope, you know, they have something to look forward to. Yeah, and that means a lot to persons, especially when they could, a young man could go and feed his child, you know, at the end of the week. You know, it means a lot. You make you feel responsible as a man.
Hey man, it helped me to pay a lot of bills, take care of the kids, hey man.
It helped me take care of my family, so it was enhanced for me in every angle.
It's a lot of people, when they came in, you can tell that their body language is like they felt defeated and hopeless. As beautiful Grand Bahama continued, you could watch people come into work smiling and laughing, and it's like you could see the whole energy from people change because they had purpose, they had something to do, something to look forward to every day.
I'm very excited. Every Friday when persons have been paid, they come with a joy and a happy spirit. And workers come to me and express gratitude. They are now being able to catch up on their rent. They have been able to catch up on their NIB payments. They have been able to catch up on insurance payment would have been lapsing. So it brings a joy to my heart. Persons could now start to sustain themselves based off this program.
Well, you know, after coming through that hardship, I feel like people, to be honest, people really didn't really get an appreciation for what the program was. Even myself struggled a little, but after I saw the impact, what it had on the lives, and I saw how the people were dependent on the money on Friday, after I saw it, I said, well, you know something? We really onto something here with this beautiful Grand Bahama program, because I feel like for the first time, a government was reaching the small man.
With the beautiful Grand Bahama program in full swing, Grand Bahamians became more hopeful of the future. But like all good things, this program was approaching its end. So the Minister for Grand Bahama brought the Prime Minister himself, the Honorable Philip Brave Davis, KC, to get a first-hand feel of the impact this program was having in our community.
When we were approaching the last week of the program, you could see a lot of people were like, oh man, like this is over, like now what are we gonna do now?
That was a pretty tough moment for us, narrowing down to the end where we had uncertainty where the program was about to end.
The program went on for 12 weeks and it had stopped. And when it stopped, listen, my phone was ringing off the hook. Everybody was really concerned about, you know, where they're gonna get the next meal from. They wanna, you know, come back to work. So it had a real impact on persons, not knowing they were losing their sense of hope because this program, like I say, is a holistic approach and it helped them to cover so many areas.
Remember now, the program was only to go for 3 months. When that program was about to stop after 3 months, you start hearing bickering all over the place. What am I gonna do? How am I gonna pay my bills? I mean, I was making this money now, at least it was a help to me, but now I'm not gonna be making no money.
Before this program, I wasn't doing anything at all, actually. So this right there, that's the only thing I have to depend on right now.
It's helping us to stay clean. It's helping people to stay out of problems. And I could see a better, more future if we could just extend it or make it a permanent job.
It's better than nothing, you know what I mean? Like I say, minimum wage right now, I need to go up in the Bahamas.
Sure, you have somewhere to go. You have some kind of income coming in.
I was unemployed for 4 years. So just to have this program and this initiative going, this gave me, it felt so good to be able to just pay a bill or to help my mom with stuff or to do things for my kids. You know, being home for so long made me feel depressed. And so this program actually gave me a sense of hope. I hope this can continue because it's helping so much people. It's impacting so many lives and we need stuff like this here in Grand Bahama.
I come with grand news. Y'all like that. That under the compassionate leadership of the Honorable Philip Brave Davis, the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, that this New Day government has extended beautiful Grand Bahama for...
When Ms. Moxey made the announcement that they're going to extend it for another week, like the room erupted, like everybody's like, yes, like it's another 3 months of security, like we have a job, something to do. So the energy was very, very good, and people were very, very excited.
Keep in mind now, the employment situation on the island haven't changed. So the people's situation, if you take beautiful Grand Bahama away, that haven't changed. So it's still the same situation now as it was when the program first started, if you take the program away.
Yeah, everybody was real excited because now this take them into the Christmas. And you know, now they're able to provide for the families during the Christmas holidays and even to get something for themselves. So they're really excited for this program to go on.
It gives us more time to rehabilitate them, give them a chance to learn more courses that they may go on into a different span of living and be able to maybe progress on their own.
Your hard work and dedication is delivering the results we at the Ministry for Grand Bahama envisioned when we launched this program back in April. We wanted to give hope, provide an opportunity for our people, especially our inner city residents, to make an honest living while also helping to revitalize their communities by tackling issues that have negatively affected the environment and diminished the historical and cultural beauty of our beloved island, which affects its attractiveness as a world-class destination. But before I go any further, I really wanna salute that gentleman right there, Mr. Conrad Jones. Yes, I had to rough him up a little bit. But that's what you do when you want the results that you're trying to get. But he got it. He got it right away, so don't mind him. He got it, and he worked along with the project managers. We had Mr. Todd Martin in the West. We have Mr. Franco Miller in the city of Freeport. And we have Steve Lang in East Grand Bahama. And you know what the thing is? It's because they are also passionate about their communities and passionate about people. Yeah. When you can align the two, you will have people that go above and beyond the call of duty. So we give the instructions on the projects that we want to see carried out. And listen here, they go all out in ensuring that it's delivered. And so I applaud you all.
Well, we prepare them for the corporate world. That's what we're about. Every morning we have a toolbox talk meeting where we gather everybody up and explain to them this is how it's going to go in the corporate world. This is what you have to be prepared for. So we're mentally preparing them and physically preparing them for the corporate world.
Give the ladies a round of applause.
You know, sometimes we can't let pride get the best of us. We out here, we work hard, everybody try to push daily. And I want to give a special shout out to Minister Ginger Moxey, who's pushing for everybody to be able to do something. Beautiful Grand Bahama, as well as West Grand Bahama cleanup team. We have people in East End, straight to West End. And I just want to motivate and encourage everybody to keep pushing and never let pride get the best of you. persons might be like, oh, you're on the side of the road, you're picking up garbage or you're chopping bush, but hey, it ain't what you do, it's how you do what you do.
You're gonna have this big fair, you're looking for permanent jobs, you to go and to be interviewed and talk to the labor board. Everybody know anything about that? Who all gonna be police? Stand up, quick, quick. Who all gonna be on the defense for?
I would like to thank Mr. Ginger Moxey for the opportunity for giving me a job. You know, the economy is really low right now and ain't much jobs are around and stuff like that. I'm glad that she gave me the opportunity to help me with my kids and stuff. As a single mother, taking care of our kids is very hard and there's no job out there like that. So I really appreciate what she has done for me and especially my kids, because they're able to help me and my kids.
You know, I come a long way doing things what I ain't supposed to be doing, but now I have changed my life and things get better for me.
I get laid off. I didn't know where my house rent was coming from. I don't know where my water bill, I don't know where my light bill, my insurance. I didn't know where I was getting none of that money from.
Working this roadside made me see how cleanliness is so important. To throw down a can right now, I'd be so embarrassed. Give my boss a round of applause for that. To let me know, let all us know how important it is. And look up, working on this roadside, look how much people I get to know.
Good.
We all us get friends. The sky is the limit. The sky is the limit.
I help them out. So this is the type of relationship that is growing on this beautiful Grand Bahama. Everybody's becoming like family.
Beautiful Grand Bahama has changed a lot of lives here on the island of Grand Bahama.
The program grew. We got other stuff that we started to introduce people to. A lot of people didn't know how to use weed whackers, chainsaws. Like, it is so much information that these people painting. Like, we painted basketball courts. Some of the guys didn't even know how thick the lines were, how much paint. Like, it was a lot of information. So a lot of them are really, really excited and ecstatic about that.
As the work experience of the participants grew, so did the intensity of the program as a whole. Bigger things were being accomplished over the entire island, from east to west. All had major projects being beautified through beautiful Grand Bahama.
Beautiful Grand Bahama started to tackle infrastructure. Like, we had four schools in East Grand Bahama, one in Swedenski, McLeanestown, High Rock, and Freetown. And all of the schools was destroyed after Hurricane Doreen. But now we already started to repair one of the schools under the Beautiful Grand Bahama campaign. Every community was impacted by Hurricane Doreen. But when you see you have the loss of 24 lives. That's a major impact for an area that only have a few hundred people. So when you put those memorial sites in place to remember those people, and after even some of the people when we were doing the sites, they didn't really warm up to it as much, but after they see how the site brought closure under the previous administration, you know, they move. What was easy to move, but what was hard to move, they left it. And what was hard to move was in the main channel, and you could hear the boats hitting those in the nighttime, in the daytime, in the sun, in people's face. Those were still in the main channel way. Going in the back to Abaco, we had major hazard in the middle of the creek. Huge gasoline trees in the middle of the creeks. Major obstacles for nighttime boaters in the middle of the creek. So we came in and it took a while and we moved every last vehicle or every last obstacle that was in the main channel and that was inside the creek way going to Abaco. Before the program, Hurricane Dorian, then we had a three-year stretch when there's no festival in East Grand Bahama, none. We have Corn Cracking, Coconut Fest, the Sea Fest, and the Cha-Cha Fest that's down in Freetown. None was even thinking about coming into existence. Minister Moxey came in with the program and said, listen, let's try to get these programs going back again. To get the Coconut Fest back again, I spoke with the chairman of Coconut Fest. They say if beautiful Grand Bahama didn't step in, it would have been impossible for them to have Coconut Fest. We helped with the corn cracking. They said the same thing. If beautiful Grand Bahama didn't step in, impossible. When we launched Coconut Fest, that sparked all the rest of festival back again after 3 years of dominance. So who can come to me now and say it didn't have no effect on the festival in East Grand Bahama when there was none up to the time of the program?
I also want to say thank you to the Minister for Grand Bahama for the beautification of Grand Bahama project.
Yes.
They are doing, and as I said, we have to give right where right is due. They are doing a very good job for East Grand Bahama.
You know, we did this road we're in now. This was the front road from Crabbin Bay to McLean Sound. We cleared back out and we extended all the way to Rocky Creek, right? And just the other day we had about 4 or 5 cars riding through, tourists riding through, bird watchers. And when they came, about 14 of them came through here doing bird watching. When they left here, they went to McLeanstown to have lunch. That's a spin-off. So this program and what we did is gonna last long after the impact of it, gonna last long after the program is done.
And when you look at beautiful Grand Bahama, you can see the difference. When you go in West End, driving up to West End, you could see the difference in West End. When you walk along, when you go an 8 mile walk to the seaside, you could see trees getting, they're chopping down trees. You see mothers working along men. And when you come in Freeport area, the same thing.
We started on the entrance, which is Hepburn Town, and we swept straight into Tedman Reef. After that phase was completed, we started on the seaside, what we like to call the coastal cleanup, where we like to, persons come, we feel come to the Bahamas to enjoy the waters and the sun, the beaches. So we feel like the only way that we could advertise or to sell our product if we were to clean the coastal line of these beaches, that people are more appreciative of seeing the waters as they ride the back road. So that was our second phase of the cleanup. We want to bring the tourism back into Morocco. We want persons to come back on Grand Bahama fish fry. We want persons to start on holidays, chilling out by Lover's Beach. So we want our beaches to keep clean in a more comfortable and a manageable state. Then we started with the balls, started to spot our balls, our decorative balls throughout the community. Each ball has a symbol on them that represent the communities. We went through all the government properties, such as a Morocco High School. We did a whole transformation cleanup on the premises and leading through the premises, because we can't have our kids going to school in unsafe areas. The same with Martintown Primary. We were able to give Martintown a whole new face look around their property as well. Josie Cave is in Holmes Rock. After multiple storms have ravaged Holmes Rock area, I think that area was neglected. That was a proper income for tour guides and buses, where they would transfer the tourists through the cave, and it has a lot of native trees and a very good background of the story of Holmes Rock and inside of that cave.
What I sorry about, I didn't take before a picture of Josie Cave after the storm. That was finished. And it's so amazing. I hat off to the crew who did that job, cleaning and fixing it up. I mean, to me, tourists love it. But even that's the trail alone. You see how pretty the trail is? Mm-hmm. That's the trail alone. It's beautiful. Then you got the water fountain. That sometime in Thai High it's salt, or when it's low, it's fresh. But I used to chill out there when I was young too. You know, I used to go there and chill out by myself. At that time, you could hear the water fountain. It flow and you could hear it, it's peaceful, you know, before it get destroyed. And in the cave, if you go in the cave in the summer, it cool. Mm-hmm. If you go there in the winter, and they're warm. That's the cave is basically was for when the storm come. Mm-hmm. That was the shelter.
It'll be a good sightseeing because we saw a lot of school kids take field trips there. So we want to bring it back up to par and in a more safe manner for persons to start visiting this area again.
We cleaned up the mermaid pond, beautified it, made it more tourist friendly. We did all of the graveyards down in Pinnis Point and Hunters. We cleaned them up, painted all the walls. We cleaned all the seaside, headed down to the lighthouse, Lewis Yard, Pinnis Point. We cleaned all of those areas. That's just the Hunters part of the project. Uptown, we did all of the schools, cleaned all of the fence line, and heritage. We got, did up in heritage and cleaned all of their easements, removed all the debris, and mind you, in all of the areas that we cleaned, we moved all of the debris that we accumulated and some that were there existing. So we're doing everything to beautify Grand Bahama. Everywhere that we saw debris or anything that we can clean, tracks, we were making projects as we go. We went to the old folks' home, whatever assistance they needed, we painted, fixed roof, pressure wash buildings, like anything, anywhere we went where people needed assistance, we gave them full assistance.
For example, this area with Trip Circle, you have neighbors here who had their home. This was bringing the value down for their home because, like I tell you, this was completely, you couldn't see the houses for the bushes that had this house around. And less fortunate persons who would come and sleep in these houses, and that was a concern for some of the neighbors. Like, for example, I had a young man tell me how happy he is that we fix up these houses because he have to go to work and leave his mummy home in the house by herself.
This Trip Circle project was, I can honestly tell you, was very, very challenging because when we came here, this place was a mess. Like, we had to literally cut these homes from the bottom to the top. When I say these places are very, very much dilapidated. So everything you see in here is brand new. We made these homes like as if they're new, modern. We modernized everything, and it took a lot of skillful, well-talented, gifted workers to come in here and put this project together. And then during the process, a lot of young men learn how to lay shingles, do carpentry, paint, because we brought in more skillful people to work with them. Like, this project reached so much people. This extend beyond, I think, even what Ms. Moxey anticipated.
Restoration Village 1 is the brainchild of Minister Moxey. It marries the new unit of the Ministry for Grand Bahama, Collab, and the beautiful Grand Bahama Initiative. These homes will become transition housing for displaced families, battered women and children, and other rehabilitative services. Through Collab and public-private partnerships, these homes will be supported through sponsorships of private entities and organizations, allowing people to transform their lives, much like the transformation of these buildings.
I learned a lot, especially shingling. I learned shingling, I learned boxing, I learned how to put in truss, I learned how to put in facial boards, peel and stick. It's a lot we learned. It's a lot. Anything to do with carpentry, I learned how to read a tape. I couldn't even read a tape while I'm learning. I didn't read them. But they teach, they learn all that on the same little job.
When you go and see who all are working, then you could tell. And they take pride in their work. And that's what is so amazing. They take so much pride in what they do.
Persons who came on the program and they learned new skills. Some of them were able to find other jobs, like other permanent jobs, based on the skills that they learned right here on beautiful Grand Bahama Project.
I know at the beginning of this third phase, it was implemented by the Minister Moxey. They will get certified at the end of this project. She wanted opportunities such as BTVI involved inside of it that persons may be accredited to their field of business.
After speaking to Ms. Moxey, after she came and had a meeting with us, all of the contractors, about the third phase, we all spoke about how a lot of people were excited about learning how to do stuff professionally. So with that entail, she was like, yes, she thinks it would be a good idea to bring in BTVI to expand on that so people can be more skilled and more and get some certification for those who want to. And I think she took the idea and ran with it. So a lot of people now in the program are going to BTVI for, like, I think a week at a time. They're picking groups and they go in there and getting certified for whatever skill they want to learn. And I think that's an awesome idea, because instead of just always providing people with a job, it gives them the opportunity to learn a skill so they can fend for themselves.
That's extremely important, because after this program is finished, then what? So the struggle goes on. So we need to empower the folks that is working, that after this program is over, that they'll be able to get some training, to get a decent paying job, so they could sustain their families.
It also help out with the vendor opportunity, because you know, beautiful Grand Bahama provide lunch for 350 employees per week. So they provide lunch for them every day for 350 employees. So that's split between three vendors. So that give vendors an opportunity to make money every week.
When you hire one person for beautiful Grand Bahama, keep in mind that person may have children or grandchildren. So you're not only affecting just one person, you're affecting a whole family. So if we get 50 people working for beautiful Grand Bahama, plus the cooks and the other various personnel working for beautiful Grand Bahama, think about the amount of people that is impacting in East Grand Bahama.
Me and the other two contractors, we were patronizing basically a lot of the vendors on the island. When we were buying materials, we were buying water. And so what that doesn't mean, the money circulating in the community. So if the money circulating in the community, that's barbers getting cut, hair getting, nails getting done, water bill being paid, light bill. So this just didn't affect beautiful Grand Bahama employees. This infected the whole island.
We want to say thank you to the Davis administration. We want to say a special thank you to the minister for that vision. They helped the less fortunate, putting people to work. And I give a two thumbs up to the program, because say if we didn't have beautiful Grand Bahama, you wouldn't see the difference of the island being beautified, then you would have so many persons out of a job. So I just want to say hats off to the minister for the great initiative.
This is how Bahama boys be looking right now. We in the right direction right now, making ends meet. That's all I have to say. I'd like to thank Todd Martin and everybody else on this program for helping me and keep me standing how it is now.
This program changed plenty of people right now. So if we keep it up, yes, it'll be better in my rock.
They learn conflict resolution. They learn a lot of things. So we see a big difference, and it's just good for me to get up every morning and go and just listen to the stories, and you see the happiness and you see the hope in the person's life.
And they feel that this project not only bring change to the community and beautification, but this would also enhance our way of living and bringing us together.
A lot of people that didn't have nothing to do, she helped out.
I hope this can continue, because it's helping so much people.
I myself have to invest a little bit more in myself, so that even though this is honest work, still more that we could do.
Been an opportunity for me to be able to take care of my family.
The young fellas them can work, make a dollar, young ladies also, include myself who have kids, and to see my area getting cleaned up like that to bring a joy to my heart, to see that.
So beautiful Grand Bahama, to me, if we take this concept throughout the Bahamas, I think crime will go down. Because at this particular time, you have rival gangs on the job, getting along, not fighting, and for that moment, that 8 hours in that day, dropping their weapons and getting along. So what it tells me? It tells me the issue is not as bad as we think. All they need is an opportunity.
Not the game had nothing, so we are very appreciative. That many other families in New Seminary, they're making ends meet and supporting them regardless of the situation, you know. So on behalf of us and the way to do it, they give thanks. Here we go, Joy. Thank you much.
I must say a special thank you to the Minister for National Security for continue to give folks a second opportunity.
To achieving all of this with exciting new projects, as I said, on the horizon.
May God continue to bless Grand Bahama and bless the common Bahamas. Yeah.
Beautiful Grand Bahama. It provided work and income for those in need. It brought beauty and order amongst the chaos left by hurricanes. It restored our coastlines and natural landmarks. It made our tourist attractions more attractive. It helped to expunge the records of minor offenses. It increased the property value for homeowners. It circulated funds amongst local vendors and businesses. It provided an opportunity for on-the-job training and certifications. It provided a place for battered women and children. It provided an opportunity for our community to invest in itself through Collab. This program presented an holistic approach to problem solving and should be adopted by our ministries, our island, our nation, our Caribbean, and our world.
We really have to thank the government of the Bahamas, the Honorable Philip Brave Davis, the Prime Minister, for making the sacrifice what the government made to fund this program. Because this isn't only trying times for the people, it's also trying time for the government. And I know I speak on behalf of all the workers on the beautiful Grand Bahama program, thanking the government for making the amazing sacrifice to pay for this program. And it wouldn't be fair to leave without saying thank you to our Prime Minister, Honorable Philip Brave Davis.
As we press forward, upward, onward, together, it is up to us to keep our Bahamas beautiful, clean, and pristine. We must all join hands in unity and think of innovative ways to make life better for all Bahamians, today and tomorrow. It starts here and now, with me and you, and beautiful Grand Bahama.
Beautiful Grand Bahama, it was more than just a cleanup.